Amen. Thank you. Maybe seated. It's great to see you all here today. See a lot of guests and visitors with us today. We're so glad that you came to Discovery Church. We're here to discover God's love for us in Jesus Christ and to know what difference that makes for us and to be empowered by God to live lives for His glory. And it's certainly wonderful to have you here today. Kind of celebrating a little bit today. I'm half done with my chemo treatments, which is kind of a good thing. And I get a week off from treatment, so this week's going to be really good. So, it's been a great journey, and God's faithfulness has been so wonderfully seen, and I appreciate all your prayers continuously. It's been an encouragement to me, and I'm feeling really good, so I'm thankful to the Lord for each day that I have to live for Him and to be hopefully an encouragement to you as your shepherd. And so I'm thankful to God that you're here today, and God has good things to teach us today. And so we just want to bow in prayer today. There's a lot of concerns I know we all carry in life and needs that we have, and we just want to lift them to God. Oh God, You are truly glorious and wonderful, and we are overwhelmed by You, overwhelmed that You would give Your one and only Son, that You would obtain us to be Your children with His precious blood, so that we could, Lord, we could live without the fear of death, we could live with confidence knowing our sins are forgiven, knowing that we've then extended a wonderful gift of Your mercy and kindness to us. And God, we are indebted to You to give You our praise, to give You our lives as living sacrifices back to You for the powerful and strengthening love that You shine on us every day. Lord, I know there's a lot of concerns here in the room and probably forget some, but I just want to pray for Nava today. She's here and going to have surgery on Friday, and surgeries can be scary things, and I just pray for her and Andrew that You'll just give them peace, and Lord, that You'll just see her through that surgery, and she'll know that You are present with her and the doctors and all who treat her. And Lord, we want to pray for Aria Dyer and just continue to pray for her, Lord, as she goes through her chemotherapy, and that, Lord, You will just continue to protect her and give her strength. And for her parents, Lord, and family, just pray that they will sense Your presence, Lord, just surrounding them. And think of Jan Whitmire today, Lord, as thankful, Lord, that the blast cells are going down, which is good. And we know that her blood counts are very weak, and just pray, Lord, that You'll just sustain Jan and Dwayne during this physical trial in their life. Pray for Colin today, and just pray that You'll continue to work in his life, for Rob and Nate, and as they fight with and just deal with MS, we just pray that You'll give them Your strength today and every day. And Lord, just want to lift up Johnny's friend who lost his brother and last night, and a sister a month before, two siblings and family members within a month's time, and just overwhelmed by these losses. And I pray, oh God, that You will make Your presence known to them, and that You will encourage them, Lord, and give them Your help and strength. And we think of Greg Whitmire having surgery this week for a hip, and just pray that that would be, Lord, strengthening for him as he's been battling some pain and some difficulties, and that You will just show Yourself mighty to him. We pray for Karen Tolsma, Lord, and just pray for Ronnie too, Lord, that You'll just encourage him and give them Your strength. Father, we are just grateful that You, oh God, love us enough to give us Your wisdom and to feed us from Your word, the wisdom of heaven, the wisdom of eternity, wisdom of an all-wise and infinite God. And we pray that our hearts would be receptive to the things that You want to say to us today. Lord, I want to pray for Pam today, my wife, as she is flying to North Carolina to be with her parents for a week, and just pray for the flights that they'll to be able to make them and the connections and all of that, and be able to be with her mom and my mother-in-law tomorrow as she has her surgery as well, and just sustain Molly and Pam and Joe, and just we just look to you, Lord, for your grace and help as we face different challenges in life, knowing, oh God, you are so faithful and good, and we're just desiring, Lord, to live as Christ and to knowing that dying is gaining, and we just pray that that would be our desire today as we sing this song and as the offering is received. We pray that it would be our heart's desire to live as Christ, and we give you thanks for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. The ushers will come and wait upon us for offering. Thank you for your great generosity and support of this church and what it's accomplishing in your life and every person's life, and our desire to reach others for the gospel. May God. From Acts chapter 20, verses 24 to 32. Acts 20, 24 to 32. Paul's talking to the Ephesian elders, a group of leaders he's been with for 3 years, and this is his last time that he will address them. And he says to them, "But I do not count my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry I have received from the Lord Jesus, to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. And now, behold, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom will see my face again. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. Pay careful attention to yourselves and all the flock, which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away disciples after them. Therefore be alert, remembering that for 3 years I did not cease day or night to admonish everyone with tears. And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among those who are sanctified." Thank you. You may be seated. Just a quick reminder, tomorrow night begins a new season of ministry here at the church with a marriage class, marriage enrichment class. It's nothing to be afraid of. You won't be put on the spot. It'll be a great time of learning, I think, to better ground and strengthen the most important relationship we have next to God, as if we're married, and that's with our spouse. It will create good communication, I hope. Hopefully not a lot of, elbow pushing, but something certainly that we all could benefit from. So we encourage you to think about that tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. And then a lot of the other ministries will continue. There's a whole list on the table. We did send out an email of some of the help that we're going to need for younger children's ministries with nursery, children's church, Sunday school, and those aspects. There are sign-ups here on the subwoofer this morning. Many helpers makes it a lot easier for the care to be given to the kids. And so hopefully you will pray about how God wants you to serve, because we were saved to serve. God gave us his spirit and giftedness not to sit back and listen and be taught all the time, but to take the teaching that we learned and are given and can now apply that in practical aspects of ministry and service for the kingdom of God. And so we don't want to fall short on our responsibilities that God has given to us. And so be praying about that. how you'd like to be involved and participate in some of the ministries. Now, in 1973, my family made a pretty significant move. It was in January that we moved to from North Dakota. I suppose it was back then 10 or 20 below, and wind chills were, you know, maybe 50 below. And we decided, my dad was called to a church in Southern California. And when we arrived, it was sunny and hot and about 75 degrees. So it was quite a transition for our family. It was quite a bit of a culture shock for us going from, you know, the prairies of North Dakota to the beaches of Southern California. Obviously, the climate was very different in a very pleasing way at times, right? And, you know, not to have to deal with the cold winters. The people were very diverse. We saw people from every tongue, tribe, and nation in California. Not something you saw a lot in North Dakota. Mainly white, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant, Catholic-type folks, you know, on the prairies. Not as diverse. So that was unique, hearing people speak languages you've never heard before. And then having classes where they taught you to speak these languages so that you could function. And certainly the population was massive. Endless cities and houses everywhere and people everywhere and traffic jams. And we were out on the freeway one day and kind of marveling that you can't get across town in 10 minutes anymore because of all that was going on. And so we gave up tornadoes for earthquakes, wildfires, and mudslides. And as we drove the freeways north of LA, just kind of scouting out the area, we noticed that it was very apparent from the collapsed overhead bridges and the newly replaced or covered up pavement that an earthquake had taken place not too long before we moved to the area, before we arrived. Now, I can remember the first day to a T when I experienced my first earthquake. They usually happen early in the morning. So it was like 5:30, 6 in the morning. You're sleeping soundly, getting that last bit of rest, and all of a sudden, everything just starts kind of shaking, kind of rocking. And it takes you a while as you kind of awake and go, what in the world is going on? And everything, it's like your house is rocking and you can hear the rafters shaking and rocking. And all of a sudden, it's over. About 15 seconds, and the shaking is over. So this was a pretty mild earthquake. Not like the one that they experienced in Italy this past week that, you know, just devastated just hundreds of thousands of people there. And so it gave me a sense, you know, that our house was rocking. And it said to me, John, you're not in North Dakota anymore. I mean, this is a new place. Now, areas of the world that experience earthquakes have learned from some very tragic and difficult experiences the need to beef up the building codes. And certainly in California, that's been done over the decades. Things are built a lot more secure, a lot more in mind of the fact that the ground moves periodically. And when it moves, it's going to shake and rattle and roll everything, and it's going to have to adjust to that, or it comes tumbling down and the fall is pretty significant and the damage and destruction is very, very devastating. So the warnings have been given out. People have been told how to kind of prepare themselves for these kinds of things, to take precautions in advance so that they're less likely to suffer catastrophic loss when those kinds of things. And we all know that foundations are tested in life. Foundations are tested. The foundation of your house is going to be tested by a windstorm, potentially a tornado. And you've seen what tornadoes can do to foundations and just rip what seemed a very secure house just off the foundation. And we all know the foundation of your life is going to be tested. It's going to be tested by adversity. It's going to be tested by disappointment, discouragement, defeats. It's It's going to be tested by relationships. The foundation of life is going to be tested. And the question is, how secure is that foundation? How much can it stand up against the things that come out of the sudden? A doctor's diagnosis that you weren't expecting. It's like, how in the world do I have that? Where did that come from? Maybe it's something else. Maybe it's a financial crisis. Maybe it could be something else that comes up all of a sudden you weren't thinking about. Maybe it's a marriage issue. Maybe it's a financial issue. Maybe it's something else. Foundations in life are tested. And most of your spiritual foundation is tested. And the question that we're asking ourselves in this series called Rooted and Grounded in Him is, how deep, how strong, how secure is your spiritual foundation in life? Because that foundation is going to be tested. Whether you're ready for it or not, it's going to be tested. And the other question that's going to be asked throughout this series of messages is, what are you doing currently in your life to make sure that the spiritual foundation of your life is rock solid, secure, that nothing's going to bowl that thing over, nothing's going to uproot you, nothing's going to shake you so much that you're going to waver in your faith and confidence in God. Nothing's going to shake you that will ever take the wind out of your sails so that you can't continue to praise God even in the middle of a storm. What are you doing to root and ground your life spiritually? Because life is tested. So this morning as we turn to Acts chapter 20, verse 28, Paul's in the middle of providing some parting words. You notice as I read the text this morning, he says, I'll never see you guys again. Why? Because Paul's going to take the collection of the offering for the saints in Jerusalem, and he knows that when he goes to Jerusalem, something's going to happen to him. He knows he's probably going to be arrested, maybe put to death. He's not sure, but he knows that he's not going to get back to Ephesus again. This will be the last time that he has to speak to these leaders. They formed great relationships in 3 years. Good things have happened. And leaving disciples who are fairly new in their faith behind wasn't an easy thing for the Apostle Paul, but God had called him to go to Jerusalem. So, Paul had to put a lot of faith in other people to care for this church and to care for all the churches that were influenced by Ephesus. Because as we've been learning on Wednesday night in this study of the seven churches of Asia Minor in the book of Revelation, all of those churches got their start, or the other six, from the work that began in Ephesus on the third missionary journey. The gospel went out. People witnessed testified to the good news of Jesus Christ to others. And it went to Smyrna and Pergamum and Thyatira and Sardis and Philadelphia and Laodicea. It went out. Because people were excited about their faith in Jesus Christ. They were excited that now they were living with hope. They didn't have to live like everybody else who, when their life was done and they died, weren't sure what was going to happen. They knew because of the gospel message that had been presented to them by the Apostle Paul and others who were faithful in delivering that message, hey, we don't have to fear death anymore because Christ has conquered death. He's risen from the grave. And that is the message that we put our hope and faith and trust in. And so exciting things happen in Ephesus. But as we look at this section of verses, we want to focus this morning gather from them why there's an urgent need for spiritual rooting and grounding. I think we see that in this verse. And that this is going to have to be an ongoing effort in the life of the church. Rooting and grounding disciples because of the climate that the church has been planted in. What that climate's like, what the world system is like, what the values of people in the world are like, and how that runs counter to what is going on in the life of believers. And so, we know that spiritual foundations get tested. So Paul begins this passage by identifying those who are responsible for rooting and grounding believers. Okay? Paul starts this challenge about the need, why there's an urgent requirement, responsibility to ground people in their faith, to root them and ground them in Jesus Christ. And then he begins in his appeal by identifying those who are responsible for rooting and grounding. That is, those who are overseers. It's overseers. Okay, and we have some overseers that are a part of the Ministry of Discovery Church. And I believe four or five of them are here today. Dave Hofer is here, and Jeff Heron, and Dean Larson, and Don Campbell, myself, and I don't think Aaron's here today. So those are the elders. And really, the first part of the sermon is to them. You get to listen on how God's word talks to these overseers that God has put in place over the church body. So overseers are to be mindful of their own rooting and grounding, as well as the spiritual stability of those that they lead. Notice Paul gives two charges, two commands, two responsibilities to the overseers, those who have been entrusted spiritual oversight over this particular church. Number one, he says, you're to pay close attention to your own spiritual life. Okay? They're responsible to root and ground their own lives in the truth. So elders, including Pastor John, because he's one, our responsibility is to root and ground our lives in the truth. We're responsible to grow in our understanding of God's word through learning and practical implementation of the things that we learn, so that we can be a model and example to other people of what a rooted and grounded life looks like. Now that sounds like a pretty heavy order, doesn't it? A tall responsibility. But that's what Paul is asking them to do. They were to be serious about engaging ourselves in careful, paying close attention to our lives, so that we can ready ourselves when the spiritual opposition comes from the fierce wolves that Paul talks about, and men who speak twisted things, attempting to draw away disciples to themselves. Right? We're to do this so that the disciples we guide will be provided with a very godly example to follow. And that's following the command that is given by Peter in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 3, being examples to the flock. So, elders or overseers, those put in charge, those to give spiritual oversight to a church, have been entrusted with this position, and they're to pay close attention to their own life, to live in an exemplary way, because people are watching them. And it's like, you remember last week I gave the illustration. I think you guys like this illustration because you told me about it. We talked about the Olympics and the eight rowing in the boat, right? The eight, and they had a coxswain on the front of the boat. And the coxswain is the only one that's looking forward. The rest are rowing. And they listen to the voice of the coxswain. And we said that that voice of the coxswain is Jesus Christ. And we are in the boat as Christians following his command. And that's the way to be rooted in ground, following Jesus. But we see that Jesus has enlisted, and I'm not sure why, but Jesus has enlisted men to speak through them and to give them oversight, and they are listening to Christ, and as Christ speaks to them, they call the commands to the body. And as they listen to Christ, they say stroke and row. They lead the church in Christ's ways. So they're like under-shepherds of the chief shepherd, or they're under-coxswains of the chief coxswain, who are helping to row the boat in a straight direction so that the disciples can continue on in their growth and maturity in Jesus Christ. And the Apostle Paul made this, you might think it's an audacious, kind of proud statement, but he says, follow me as I'm following Jesus Christ. Why did he say that? Because he knows he's been given the command as a Christian, as a leader, to live his life as an example to others. That's why in my life, I've made some choices, personal choices, with the freedom that I have in Christ to do some things and to not do some things, because for me to do certain things might not be a good example to you. Or to not do some things might not be a good example to you. That's why I have to really do soul searching my life, to examine my life very closely, because I don't want to lead you astray. I want to give you an example to follow. And sometimes I don't do very well with that, because I'm in the process of growing just like everyone else. But it's something that I have to be thinking about, and all leaders have to be thinking about. Paul said to Timothy, keep a close watch on yourself and on your teaching. Persist in doing this, for by doing this, you will save both yourself and your hearers. So if I pay close attention to my teaching and I teach you the truth about Jesus Christ and the salvation he offers through Christ working through my life, salvation can come to your lives as you put your faith in Jesus Christ to trust him. Now, second, it says they are responsible. The leaders not only supposed to pay close attention to self, but look at the second thing. They're responsible to pay careful attention to all the flock. All the flock. You see that? So everyone in here, we're to pay attention to every one of you. I got to pay attention to every one of you. Every one of you. Not just some of you. Not just have a few favorites that I like. But it's all the flock. Pay attention to all the flock. And certainly this is in line with what it means to be an overseer. An overseer isn't simply a person in a position of a spiritual authority to make decisions, to decide things, to be in charge of a church and to run it like a business or an organization. It's not that. As much as it is, it's someone who works diligently to care for those spiritually who are under their watchful spiritual care. That's what an overseer does. We care about you spiritually. We care about your spiritual life, where you're going. We want to make sure that you're prepared for things, you're ready for things, that we've done the best job equipping you and preparing you for the things and the challenges and the obvious testing of the foundations of our life that's going to come. And spiritual overseers, as you can see in the passage, are caring for the most precious thing on this planet. Okay? The most precious thing on this planet is the church of God, which has been obtained with his own blood. I think that's a very important statement that Paul is making to the Ephesian elders to help them not in any way minimize the importance of every person in their church body. Because if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you are the most precious thing on this earth, because you have been obtained for salvation through his precious blood, Jesus' blood. I think it's easy for people in our day to minimize the importance of the church. But it's very clear from this verse, the supreme value that God puts on the church. He obtained it with his own blood. If you're a part of the body of Christ, you got there through Christ's blood. God obtained you for your salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ. It costs God a lot. A great expense, a great price for the church, this church, to come into existence. It cost Christ his own blood for us to be here today. So that we could celebrate and worship and learn and grow. And I think people in our day and age tend to confuse church with a building, right? It's a building. It's that cool little place on 205 West 3rd Street. It used to be an old furniture store. That's our church. No, that's where we meet. It's a building. The church is you. If you're a Christian, You are the church. We are the church. The church is not an organization that's run, you know, in a certain way. The church is a living organism of multiple people that covenant together to do the work of the gospel. They're saved, sanctified, set apart people who are knowledgeable that they are the most precious thing on this earth because they've been bought with his own blood. So the church is so special to God. So special. So precious. Believers are precious in his sight. Every one of you, if you're a believer in Jesus, you are special. God wants you to know that. That's one of the things that the scriptures continuously tell us, that our position in Christ is a valuable position. The world may not value that. They might think you're junk or you're worthless or, you know, you're not stroking life with them. But I'm telling you, if you've been purchased with his blood, your life is precious. And it means something to God. And surprisingly, I say, God entrusts oversight to this very special possession to men that he's empowered and equipped and called by his Holy Spirit. So elders who are here today, we've been given charge to care for a very special possession of God. It's people who have been obtained by God for his own possession by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, sometimes the most difficult thing for leaders attempting to pay attention, careful attention, it says, to all the flock, okay? Just going to be honest with you here this morning, because you know I kind of say it like it is sometimes, but it's very difficult when we're trying to pay attention to all the flock when members of the flock demonstrate some reservations to leaders paying close attention to them. You see, we're not called a flock for no reason. We're called a flock because we're sheep. We're like sheep. And sheep can be very independent. Sheep can be very stubborn. Sheep can be very self-motivated. Sheep can often struggle to receive direction and nurturing and caring because they like to kind of venture out on their own. They like to kind of keep others at arm's length from knowing their business, knowing their life, knowing how they're doing spiritually. And some disciples like to maintain a very independent posture in life. I don't want you to know what's going on. But it makes it difficult for those who've been charged with caring for them to care for them. Right? So what I'm saying through all of this is all of our elders, to do our job the way Christ has asked us to do it, we need your help. We need your help. We can't do this alone. We need your help to fulfill this responsibility. The best way for leaders to care for people is through maintaining regular contact with those leaders as you participate in church ministries where leaders are a part of that. That's the best way. Because it's gotten really hard to care for people today because most people don't answer their phones. You get an answering machine. You get a voicemail. Life has gotten very impersonal. Many of our older people remember the old days in church when you know, the family went to church all day, and it was a part of their daily, their Sunday activity was just going. We didn't have television. This is back in, we were talking, this is the 40s, 50s. People said it was just a day that the church, people were really close-knit. They were really tied. They were in small communities. They know everybody, and there was something, a part of their life that was very intimate, personal, you know, and sometimes it wasn't always good because there was gossip and all that other kind of stuff, but life has gotten very much impersonal these days, hasn't it? Even texting and all this kind of stuff, you know, is very impersonal. It's a way to keep people at an arm's length from you. And I don't know about you, but I haven't grown very well in my spiritual life when I'm just a lone ranger off on my own And no one can hold me accountable for stuff in my life. I just don't do very well. I don't think any of us do really well unless people are asking us sometimes some very good questions. Like, how's it going in your prayer life? Or how's it going? What are you reading? And what is God showing you from his word that's really helping you in your life today? Accountability is a really important part of life, to stay grounded, to stay focused because of what's coming. So I appreciate your cooperation. And however you can help us as we take on a very significant task, but it's kind of overwhelming. Because y'all don't know, I'm going to be judged for how well I did. Whether you cooperate or not, how well I shepherded you. I'm going to be judged for that. I'm going to get stricter judgment from God because of this responsibility. That's why I need your help. I'm not going to barge into your life. I just don't think that's what God wants me to do. But I will be here to preach the word as long as I have life. You know that. And I will put together, with the help of the elders, ministries to help ground and encourage us and to get us together to encourage each other and pray for each other as we face those battles in life. Because a lot of times when we face the spiritual testing of our life is when we're out all by ourselves. There isn't a bunch of Christians standing around us going, hey, wait a second, or hey, I'm with you. It's when you're out in the workplace. It's when you're on the job. It's when you're at school. It's in the other quiet times of your life that the savage wolves come at you. And so we want to come together as a church, however we can, to fellowship around the Word so that we can ground each other and encourage each other so that when we're out on our own, the enemy doesn't see us like the howling pack of wolves saying, oh, that's an easy target. Because the enemy sees you as an easy target if he knows you're not grounded. He knows you're vulnerable when you're not grounded, when you're not in fellowship with God, with Jesus Christ, with the Word, with other believers. He knows that. He knows when you are down, when you are weak. He knows when you are acting solely based on your emotions and not on the truth of God's Word. That's when the devil, that's when the howling wolves come to seek to devour you. And notice, the fierce wolves don't spare the flock. They show no mercy. They want your destruction. They want you to uproot your life spiritually from the rock, Jesus Christ, and the foundation that you have. The enemy wants to do that. That's why Paul says the reason why we root and ground one another is really imperative. Outside sources will come to seek to destroy this church. Do you know that? There are outside sources working every day, every moment of the day, working to destroy this church that was obtained with the blood of Jesus Christ. And the outside wolves are very cunning. They're very deceptive. I don't know if you know the ways of wolves, but the ways of wolves are, they don't just run up to a deer and say, here I am. Look out. They have to be pretty smart about what they do. They have to be very covert, undercover. They have to be very tricky, some trickery in what they do to get their job done. And you notice wolves always go in a pack. There's not usually just one of them trying to take down a deer. There's five of them. And I know after my departure, fierce wolves will come among you. Isn't that interesting? Paul's just telling him, when I leave, boom, you're going to be tested. There's going to be fierce wolves, and they're not going to spare the flock. And beginning with this phrase, and the one that follows, Paul establishes for all churches why spiritual rooting and grounding cannot be neglected. This is a serious thing. So when you know what the enemy's up to, you're going to find that out. There are forces at work outside this church that are seeking to destroy and make their way into this church through individual lives to disrupt and destroy this body. These fierce forces are called fierce wolves. Cunning, deceptive, travel in packs to overwhelm the unsuspecting prey. And when the sheep are independent and prone to stray, who lack good order and firmness in their faith, the wolves show no mercy. They will not spare the flock. As Paul was talking, he was referring to the false teachers of the day. The false teachers that have always been present in society. During Paul's day, there were many sources. It was the Greek society. They were very into knowledge. They were very much into people on the street corners trying to gather followings after their line of thought, their philosophy, their understanding of how things worked in life. There were many sources of false teaching that the church had to deal with during Paul's day, trying to gain the ear and the following and the affirmation of whoever they could get. It was everywhere. And most of the false teacher would exploit those who were weak and naive. They just didn't know what they believed. And I have to say, there's probably a lot of Christians today that really do not know a thing about what they believe. That doesn't come just sitting in church on Sunday morning. There has to be some discipline to study and learn understanding. You know, we sang that song. I picked that one this morning about the song with the creed, I believe in God the Father. You know, those are things that we need to root our lives in, understanding that they're the resurrection from the dead and the Holy Spirit and the salvation comes through Jesus Christ alone. Those are all things that root and ground our life, because there's a lot of teaching in our society that do not agree with that. False teaching is very prevalent in our day. And the false teachers of our day, the fierce wolves of our day, are very, very subtle, very, very deceptive, while at the same time very, very effective in working their way into the lives of believers. They're very effective in working our way into our lives. And most of the false teachers of the day, I believe, work through the media, because it's just easy, because we have such easy access to it. Your kids have iPads, and they can get on Wi-Fi and watch stuff, and we got television with millions of channels, and you know, we have instant access to all kinds of false teaching. Some of the biggest false teachers in our society are Hollywood stars. Lady Gaga is a false teacher. Her songs are false teaching. And how many kids can sing Lady Gaga songs? Katy Perry grew up in, I think, in a Christian home. Is so much anti that today. Just listen to their song. Watch their lifestyle. What are they teaching? What are they saying? You're the master of your own destiny. Whatever sexual thing you want to do, go do it, whatever. And that little punky kid, Bieber, he's a false teacher. But how many girls? Oh, he's here. False teaching you. Look at his lifestyle. What's he all about? He's about himself. He doesn't care if he destroys you as long as you pay him so he can have his lifestyle. That's all they care about. That's all. Any movie producer, they don't care about what destruction comes to your mind, to your heart, through the false teaching that they present on the screen. They don't care about you. All they care about is that you'll pay for it and they'll get you enticed. Pornography, people, used to be a man's problem. It is everybody's problem today. It is so prevalent. They are fierce wolves that want to destroy you. They don't care about your purity. They don't care about your marriage or future marriage. They want to enslave you so that you can buy and pay for it the rest of your life. They don't care about your shame. They don't care about your guilt. They don't care about the fact that when you get involved in this, you feel less likely to want to be involved in a church ministry that helps you get free from this because you feel so guilty and dirty. They don't care about you. They're full of fierce wolves. They don't spare anybody because they're so prevalent, they're unlegislated, they have such freedom to convince people. 225 died last week in heroin overdoses. Fierce wolves. How many casino commercials do you see on television? Fierce wolves. Very deceptive. It means win. We can give you this. We can give you that. You can have that. Come, become rich. If you just put it in our slot machine, our one-armed bandit, you're gonna get that money you were looking for in life. Lottery. You got a 1 in 350 million chance of winning. False teaching. The current sexual values of the world today that are so amiss from Scripture is false teaching. And it's done with poignant stories, Olympic stories done on this, that, and the other thing, showing about the new breed of sexuality and all it's going in society. That isn't what God says. It's false teaching. It's everywhere. But the posture of a lot of Christian kids is, and you look at some of their tweets, and there's vulgarity and certain gestures with certain fingers of things that they're passing on that they got from someone else, and they're retweeting it, and parents are clueless. It's false teaching. And you like to think every day you send your child off to school, it's just going to be reading, writing, and arithmetic, right? Not anymore. And it grieves my heart. Can't even have kids in Sunday school anymore. They know this world better than they know Jesus. They could sing Lady Gaga's song, but they can't tell you where John 3:16 is. They can quote a lot of filthy things, but they can't tell you what God's word says that's going to ground their life when life gets tough. Fierce wolves. They're out there. They're destroying children today. They're leading them astray into a worldly system of values. And because parents just don't take that much time, that much interest, we don't want to create conflict with our kids. We just give them what they want. Paul says, when I depart, they're going to come in and they're not going to spare you. They're going to indoctrinate you into their values, into their system, into their worldview, which is not the biblical worldview. It's not the worldview that's presented to us in Scripture. Rooting and grounding is so important. Worldly false teaching encourages our defection. It encourages us to walk away from Jesus rather than walk to Him, walk in Him, walk in dependence of Him. I cannot monitor every person in this flock's media input. I can't. I can only do my own. And that's something I have to keep a close watch on myself. All I can do is make you aware of the very subtle and deceptive nature of false teaching in our day and to warn you, it does have the power to influence your life away from holiness and away from righteousness and away from godliness and away from moral purity. It does. And it does it very subtly, very sinisterly. It's a fierce wolf that's just praying at your soul and will not spare your soul. Worldly false teaching will perpetuate lukewarmness. Lukewarmness. We studied that on Wednesday night. The church of Laodicea is the church before Jesus comes. Laodicea is the church that is not hot and it's not cold. It's lukewarm. It's tepid. It's lost its fire. It's lost its excitement for Jesus. It's spiritually blind. It's spiritually poor. It's spiritually naked. But it thinks it's rich, clothed, got it all together. It's the only church that Jesus has nothing good to say about. And His only message is repent. Repent. Change your ways before it's too late. As I watched it, I just go, oh God, I don't want to be a pastor of a church at Laodicea. That's why I say hard things sometimes. Some things that might rub you a little bit the wrong way, but if you go and think about it and pray about it, I'm not here to beat people down as much as to warn, just as the prophets warned. I was reading the book of Jeremiah. I looked at him for 41 years, this man. Proclaimed, he pleaded with people to walk in faith, to reclaim the ways that God had set before them as a people, and to not waver from that. And what happened? They all turned their back on him. They said, that'll never happen. God will never destroy Jerusalem. He was beaten. He was mocked. He was thrown in a cistern and left to die. That's why he's called the weeping prophet, because he pleaded and he pleaded and he pleaded. People wake up. People wake up. People wake. Judgment's coming. The fierce wolves are seeking to devour. But it's not too late. Because God will hear your cry. God will turn it around in your life. God will begin a new work in your life if you repent and return to Him. And that's my message to you today. God will do a good work in your life. He will turn things around if it needs a turnaround. But the key thing is we need to be rooted and grounded in Jesus Christ. That good order and the firmness of our faith can never waver, because the fierce wolves are always there. The spiritual leaders of this church have committed ourselves to you, to all the flock, to care for you. And the way that we are going to care for you the best is we're always available. If you need us for anything, to call, to help, to pray with you, to lift you up. But we've designed ministries for you to take part in. And sadly, very few of you take part in them. That's just the way it is. I know there's schedules and times and all of this. But we've lined up Bible studies and ministries to help ground people in their faith. And that's really all that we can do. It's like you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. So we've tried to cover different times, different opportunities, from marriage to grief share, to ladies' Bible study, to men's Bible study, to small groups. We're covering the whole thing. And we just hope somewhere it'll stick with your life, so that we can help you and encourage you to stay rooted and grounded in Jesus. so that we can help you to detect the wolves, the fierce wolves that are out there that want to destroy your life. I didn't finish this sermon. I guess you'll have to come back next week to get the rest. But Paul said to the Ephesians, make the most of the time because the days are evil. And so I really believe that's what we got to do. See, here's my vision for this church. My vision is to equip you with such an excitement for Jesus Christ that you'll go out and you will reach your neighborhood, your community, your workplace with the good news of Jesus. That's what my excitement is. You discover the truth that sets you free, and when you walk in the freedom of Jesus, people are going to see it, and they're going to come to Christ. They're going to want us to know what makes the difference in your life. You have hope. You have purpose. You have joy in your life. You're going through struggles, but it doesn't seem to bother you. You have a great outlook on life. Why? Because I have Jesus in my life. He's at the center of my life. I'm grounded in Him. That's a vision I have for this church. Equip, encourage, build you up, so that you can be a powerhouse of disciple makers in the marketplace. And you can tell people, come to Discovery Church, because there's a lot of hope here. There's a lot of encouragement here. Yeah, he's gonna rattle our cages a few times, right? I do that. But it's only because I love you. Because you are the most precious thing on earth. You are the most precious thing on earth. You've been bought with His blood. That means something. It means something to me. I hope it means something to you. I hope you cherish that if you're a believer in Jesus, you're the most special thing on earth because God went to great expense to reveal that to you. And today, if you're not a believer, if you're not a Christian, you can become one. You can become the most precious thing on earth by admitting to God you've sinned, you've fallen short. Yes, God, I've sinned. But accepting that Jesus died for those sins, He paid the price so that you could be set free and that Jesus could become a part of your life as you open your life to say, Jesus, I receive you. I want you. I want to walk with you. I want to get in your boat and I want you to direct my life forever. You pray that. You mean that. Jesus will come in. If you do, I want to know that. You tell me that. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you've revealed to us some very precious things today, some difficult things. Lord, we need lots of help because sometimes we don't detect the fierce wolves until the pain is already set in. We're addicted to something. We're disrupted by something. Life is already in shambles. There's fierce wolves out there trying to destroy our marriages. There's fierce wolves out there trying to destroy our family life. There's fierce wolves that are out there trying to destroy us individually with defeat, with enslavement to all kinds of things that will not fulfill us but only leave us further empty and shameful. Lord Jesus, help us to know that only you can fill us. Only when we ground our lives in you will we be most complete and most satisfied. And I pray that through this series of messages, Lord, you will do a mighty, mighty, mighty work to make us deeper and stronger and more committed to walk with you and to trust you and to live for you. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand as we sing our lives.